discuss yesterday. So what materials we can use for solar cell, and we cannot use metal and insulator for very good reason. What else? We can use the combination of materials to get a best optical and electrical properties, okay. And how to tune the tuning up the band gap, material tuning is we can do. Why we come to the 14%, all the way from 100% we have looked at the various losses in terms of the transmission, in terms of the higher energy photons, in terms of the recombination and some other losses that will happen at the junction and the contacts, okay. Very nice. What else? Challenge in the PV cells, okay. Any technology, any solar cell that you want to develop in future, you must be take care that it has, you know, smaller energy payback period, smaller money payback period, material is abundant, there is more efficiencies are good enough and things like that. Yeah, sorry. The fill factor and the open circuit voltage and the short circuit current, and that reminds me of the homework that I have given to you. Thank you very much. You done the homework? No? Okay, fine. So so today was just introduction, you know, what are the possible issues that actually goes with the solar cell, and today what we will go is little deep into the theory. Again, it's not a complete thing because the whole P-N junction theory takes about 8 to 10 hours of discussion. So this is again not to be going to be sufficient, but we'll you'll get a kind of basic idea how the solar cell works, and therefore what we are discussing yesterday, you know, how to generate a how the voltages get generated, you'll make little more clear from the today's lecture. So we'll look at the P-N junction theory. In so what we are going to look at is this basic points, the carriers, the drift of the carriers, diffusion of the carriers, generation and recombination. So these are the four major things that happens, okay, drift of the carriers, diffusion of the carriers, generation and recombination. This is how you define the device operation. In any solar cell, these four things are happening all the time, always, and we need to understand this processes very well, so that then we can actually design a new kind of solar cell, or even if solar cell is not performing well, or if it is performing well, we can understand which of the process is actually contributing to the good performance or not so good performance. And again, then we'll try to look at the IV equation of the diode in a very qualitative manner. The quantitative description or the proof requires a little bit more time, which we don't have for this workshop. But we'll look at the equation of the diode, and then we'll look at the equation of the solar cell, which we are ending at the point we ended yesterday. So the carrier drift and diffusion, these are the two forces that acts upon a charge carrier or the carrier, simply a particle, which results in the motion of the charge particle or just the particle. Drift is a phenomena that happens in presence of the electric field, okay. The carriers moves because there is electric field. In our solar cell, the electric field does not exist everywhere, it is only at the junction there is electric field. And at the other part of the junction, there is a very weak electric field. That we will see how it works. The diffusion is phenomena in which carriers move because of the concentration gradient. So that is a force. The force behind the motion of the carriers due to the diffusion is the concentration gradient. Generation, as we have seen yesterday, we'll look at little more detail. What is the absorption coefficient, absorption length, and how much? What should be the absorption coefficient, and what is the material thickness requirement, and so on. And then the recombination, what are the various mechanism by which the carriers recombine, we have seen yesterday, but we will go a little bit more into detail. And then qualitatively we will try to put the equation of the diode, P-N junction diode, and we will modify it for the solar cell. So that is the agenda today. In any semiconductor, the electron is moving, so E is electric field here. By the way, I wanted to make one correction before we go further. Regarding yesterday, we had actually get the approximate value of h nu, right? And I wrote that it is 1.124 lambda in micrometer. Well, this is wrong. The correct answer is 1.24 lambda in micrometer. Okay. From this calculation, the highest photon energy was coming to about 3 electron volt, and the lowest was coming about 0.28 electron volt. From this calculation, that number I think will become about 3.5 electron volt, and the lowest is about 3 point something electron volt. Okay, so this so actually not 1.124, it is 1.24. So that's correction that you can make. Okay, well, and this has come simply from putting h nu, nu equal to c over lambda. You put the value of c and put the value of h, the Planck's constant. You will get the value which is 1.24 and lambda in the micrometer. Nothing great about it. Okay, so in any semiconductor, if you are not putting any electric field, applying any electric field, okay, another thing is this E is actually normally used many times for the potential energy, and the symbol zeta is used for electric field. Okay, so this E here is actually electric field. The electric field, so when this electric field is zero, the electron is moving all the time. Why it is moving? Why it moves? The electron is moving all the time, right? So this is electron, it goes here, 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 random motion, it is going all the time here and there, even if there is no electric field. Why do you think it moves? It keeps on moving all the time? Because of the thermal energy. It is still at even room temperature, it still has enough energy to go around, okay? But the net motion is 0. The net motion is 0. Therefore, if net motion is 0, what, which means what? Current is 0, okay? No charge transfer per unit time. So, dq over dt is 0, and therefore current is 0. So, without electric field, the net current is 0. When there is a non-zero electric field, when you apply some electric field, this electron will experience a force, and it will still go through the random motion, but there is a, in total there is some motion happening, which is in the direction opposite to the electric field, right? Force on the electron is in the direction opposite to the electric field. Is that clear to everybody? If I take a big positive charge, right, this is the direction of the electric field. If I keep an electron, negative electron, it will move in this direction. Okay, so this is the direction of electric field, and this is the direction of electron. So the motion, electron motion, is in the opposite direction of electric field. Okay, so what you see here is this electron is actually going through the further. So it is not straight path, because why? It is colliding with the available the electrons in that particular semiconductor. So, it is not going to the straight path, but it assumes some certain velocity in the direction opposite to the electric field, right? And that velocity, so the time it takes from going to here, that velocity is an average velocity, you can say, because it is going here, 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 okay? So, it assumes a certain velocity against the force which is there because of the non-zero electric field, and that velocity is normally referred as a drift velocity. Okay, that velocity is referred as a the drift velocity. So you can see there is a force which is equal to in the negative direction because of negative sign, electric field, and the electron accelerate and deaccelerates, accelerates and deaccelerates. Deaccelerates because of the collision it is going through, and as a result it gets the average drift velocity, right? So now there is some current flowing. Right, because there is a net displacement of a charge from one point to other one, there is some current flowing. Let us say the concentration of electrons in that particular case is n. Can you write the expression for the current? Write it. What is current? Dq or dt. Okay, so you need to write how much charge is flowing per unit time, and you should get the divided by the time, and you should get the current. Can you write the expression for the current? So what you want? We want expression for the current, which should be this. Okay. So what I said, how many charge are there? You can assume a concentration of, let us say n, let us say electrons are moving. So n electrons per unit volume. Okay, normally in a solid you give concentration n electrons per unit volume. Okay. Now if I multiply with the charge q, then I am having nq charge per unit volume, right? Ideally what I need? I need charge per unit time. If I multiply this, so if I multiply this with velocity, drift velocity, then what I got? So this is per unit volume, centimeter cube, and this is centimeter per second. So this will cancel out, we will get 2 here. And if I multiply with the cross section area which is in centimeter square, so this will get cancelled out, and this was having the unit of charge. Now I am getting the per unit time, right? This was having unit of charge coulomb, and this is per second. So what I got eventually, NQVD, and this is having unit nothing other than the coulomb per second, which is the current. Okay. So if in any case, if there are concentration of n particles per unit volume moving with the velocity Vd across the cross section area. So I have A also from here. Across the cross section area A, then the current that will be flown in that condition will be NQVdA. That is the current that I have. Okay. Now this current is because of the drift. So you can call it I drift. And I assume that the particle is electron here, n, right? So I can say I drift because of the electron. Right? Is that clear? Now same thing can also happen with the folds, exactly same. So just coming back here, if the direction of electric field is this, the motion of electron is in the other direction. So the electrons are moving here. Electrons are moving here, and because electrons are moving in this direction, the current is moving here. Okay. So direction of current is same as direction of electric field. So there is no negative sign, same, right? Direction of current is same as the direction of electric field. Is that point very clear to everybody? Okay. Now look at the holes. Put a electric field here, the hole force will be there, and therefore current will also be in the moving in the same direction. So again the direction of electric field and the direction of current will be the same for the holes also. Okay, now let us write the expression for the hole. Let us say hole concentration is P number per unit volume. So my expression for the drift of holes will be same PQVDA. So the drift current is similar to the drift current for the electron and drift current for the holes. Okay, and direction of the current for both electron as well as hole is in the same direction as the direction of electric field. Clear, everybody? Direction of the current for both electron as well as hole is in the same direction as the direction of electric field. Yes or no? Yes, everybody? Not everybody seems to be convinced. A is area. Okay, I am considering cross section area because you consider the volume, right? So if I take a cross section area there like this, so this is area, this is the where the electric field is applied. So this is a cross section area. If any doubt, please ask. We have lot of time. No hurry. If you are not asking, I am going to ask you the question. Ready? See, you cannot be neutral, you have to this side or this side. Like Bush, you are with me or you are against me. Cannot be neutral. So is that clear? The expression for the right current is very simple. You can write drift current expression for any other situation. Very simple. You have to just say how many charges moving per unit time over a cross section area. Okay? This is very simple. Now this is expression, this is in terms of current, but you can also write I drift per unit area, so you will get PQVD. If you are writing this, then what is this? It is current density per unit area. And many times we in solar cell we talk about the current density. Like yesterday when I told you that ISC, I told you current density. So how much current is flowing per unit area? So you can refer it to the current or current density. Okay, these are the same expression, we will not go into the detail, sorry. So these are the same expression, we will not go into the details, but eventually arrived at the current density. The expression for the current density is normally J, we commonly use expression for the current density is J, and I is the current. I is the current, J is the current density we are considering. So, I mean, we have considered because the force is also in the negative direction. So, the charge on electron is negative and the force direction is negative got cancelled, and therefore, the net is positive. Okay, there is a the force on electron is also in the negative direction, and there is a negative charge coming because of the minus Q. So, both cancel out, and therefore, in simplicity what we have looked, the direction of electric field is the same as the direction of current, which means everything is cancelled out. There are two negatives in that expression. Okay, one another parameter which is very, very important that we need to define is how much the velocity a particle attains per unit electric field. Okay? Okay, what is the velocity the particle can attain per unit electric field? Analogy very simple, right? If there is a runner which runs on a smooth road, and if there is a runner which runs on the rough road, okay, the runner, same runner, same strength, everything same, it will run faster on the smooth road, right, than the rough road. Is that clear? Same thing will happen to electron also. When electron is moving in a crystal, if the crystal is perfect without any disorder, without any defects, without any impurities, then it will run faster, or the velocity it will attain is higher as compared to the case when the crystal is defected. Okay? And the examples of the defected crystals are polycrystalline silicon. Okay? Example of defected material is cadmium telluride, CIGS, and amorphous silicon, very defected. Okay? So, what does it mean? For a given electric field, the velocity that an electron will attain in the defected material will be higher or lower? Just to check, it will be lower, right? The velocity that electron will attain in a defected material will be lower than the velocity it will attain in a perfect crystal. And that is represented by a parameter called mobility, mu. Okay? So, mu is nothing but velocity or drift velocity per unit electric field. So, so in a good crystal, the mobility is high, in a not good crystal, the mobility is low. Okay? From solar cell perspective, we would always like to have high mobility. Okay, so, this is one of the important electrical property, right. I said yesterday two properties we need to get the best, one is optical, other is electrical. High mobility is one of the important electrical property that we are always looking for. Okay, so, when people are trying to develop the materials and trying to get the job done, so they are actually trying to what kind of velocity that you can get. What kind of drift velocity you can get for a given electric field. And this is the parameter which can vary a lot. The mobility is one of the key parameter for a scientist, and it can really vary a lot depending on the condition and the defects and the impurity, etc. So, keep this in mind. This is a very important parameter for solar cell, right. Everybody will remember mobility. What is the unit of mobility? This is centimeter per second, this is volt per centimeter. So, overall centimeter square per volt second, centimeter square per volt second. Right. Okay, there is a drift current for the electrons and there is a drift current for the holes. What is the total drift current for both electrons and holes? Right. What is the total drift current? Sum of the electron drift current and the hole drift current. So, mobility, as I said, is one of the important parameter, and the various numbers you can see here. The mobility of electron for silicon is 1350 centimeter square per volt second, and for holes 480, for germanium 3900 and 1900. The total current density for the drift current density is the sum of the two current density. So, what we have done in this expression is we have used this expression. Okay. So, Vd in your expression can be replaced by mu times electric field, right. Vd can be replaced by mu times electric field, and therefore, expression for the Jn and Jp will become Qn mu n zeta and Qn mu q. I am sorry, this should be, what is the mistake here? This should be P. So Q p mu p theta. And the subscript for the mu n and mu p is different because the mobility for electron and holes are different, right? So you can put together the sum of the two current component is this, okay? And if you actually look at this carefully, this is nothing but the Ohm's law, okay? J equal to sigma e zeta, actually electric field is the Ohm's law, right? V equal to IR. If you do that analysis, you will come to the same expression. So this expression is nothing but the Ohm's law. So what is the expression for, and this sigma is what? So this expression is nothing but the conductivity, okay? So what is the expression for the conductivity? Q in the bracket n mu n p mu p, okay? So you can find out the conductivity of the material. If you know the mobility, if you know the concentration of electrons, you can find out the conductivity. Q is known. If you know the conductivity, you can find out the, what also you can find out? Resistivity. If you know the resistivity, you can find out the resistance. So knowing the doping, knowing the number of electrons and holes and knowing their mobility, you can find out lot of parameters about the material, okay? Knowing the n mu n, p and mu p, you can find out the total current density, you can find out the current. If you know the area, you can find out the conductivity, you can find out the resistivity, you can find out the resistance, etc. Okay, so far with me, everybody with me? Very good. So this is one mechanism by which electrons move. The mobility, by the way, is not a constant, it depends on the doping density, okay? If you dope more, your mobility decreases. Any idea why? Very simple. Doping more means you are disturbing it more, right? So because there are silicon atoms sitting, now you are doping with some concentrations, you are putting more and more boron or phosphorus, which means you are disturbing your lattice more, which means you are making the path of this electron rougher. And therefore, as you dope more and more, the velocity it will attain, the drift velocity will attain will be lower and lower, and therefore mobility lower. So for a very high doping level, transfer 17, 18, 19, you can see the mobilities are smaller for both electrons and holes. Mobility is also a function of a temperature, okay? So initially, if you increase the temperature, mobility increases, but after some increase in temperature decreases because the lattice vibration starts. Okay, so the atom starting vibrate, and therefore it decreases. Yeah, so doping density means if we have p type silicon and n type silicon, right? And we have just silicon, intrinsic silicon, but in order to make a junction, we need to make it p type. How do we make it p type? We put boron into it, and so the how much boron is there in silicon, that is the doping density, okay? Okay, good. So this is a 10^15 boron atoms per centimeter cube in silicon. By the silicon, what is the atomic density of silicon? In 1 cm³ of silicon, how many silicon atoms are there? Very easy to calculate, but I'll give the number directly. So 5 × 10^22 atoms of silicon there in per centimeter cube. That is silicon atom density. Now when we do doping, we put boron into silicon, okay? That boron doping is normally in the range of 10^16 atoms of boron in silicon per centimeter cube, okay? That is the doping density. So when you say, when there are 10^16 atoms of boron in silicon, we say doping density is 10^16. What does it mean? How many atoms of boron are there in per silicon? So what is the difference? 10^16 to 22. So 1 million, for 1 million atoms of silicon, there is one atom of boron, right? Silicon atom is 10^22. Boron is 10^6. This is controlled while making silicon itself. When you make a silicon, silicon is actually melted. Okay, so in melt, so if you are putting 100 or 1 million kilogram of silicon, put 1 kilogram of boron. So then you will get this kind of doping density. Okay, so it is controlled while making silicon itself, in the melt itself. Boron, boron atom can come, I can displace silicon as well as interstation. So where is the boron going? Because crystalline silicon is silicon, right? So boron has to go somewhere. That so it's, so first of all, it is in melt, right? So when silicon is melted at very high temperature, about 1800 degrees centigrade, at that time you also put boron, and then you stir it. Okay, it's like what? Making kheer. Mix it properly, no? Put sugar or whatever you put. Mix it properly. That's it. And then when the silicon actually comes up and it gets colder and solidifies. From liquid it goes to the solid form. Within that form it is a very critical step, so that your all silicon atoms are nicely arranged. You know how many atoms? Zillions and zillions of atoms are nicely arranged, and somewhere you also get the boron atom. How many boron atoms? 1 in 1 million. Very small number still, right? If you are doing doping of 10 to the 16, only one boron atom is coming in 1 million silicon atom. Will a very still number. You can do it by diffusion, but you actually, when you grow, the silicon is grown in the form of ingot, which is like meter and a half long, 8 inch or 6 inch is the diameter. So that is done at that time. It is different from the diffusion. In diffusion also you actually insert other kind of impurities. Where you are diffusing, you are also doing similar thing. Not really. I mean, look at the number, it is so small, 1 in 1 million. Really small, but still very large. When silicon is purified, you know how much it is purified? Not 99.9, it is purified to 1 in billion atom. Then you can make your device, okay? 1 in 1 billion atom. It is similar to find one foreigner in the Indian population, in the whole of the country. That is 1 in 1 billion, right? We are almost 1 billion. You need to purify some of the impurity to that level, then only you can make a device. Of course, solar cell is more tolerant to the, more forgiving to the impurity. So you can actually make a solar cell in a higher impurity concentration also. So 1 in 1 million is also okay. And therefore, now people are trying to make. So this kind of silicon is called electronic grade silicon, very expensive. But now people are trying to make what is called solar grade silicon, because you are allowed to have more impurities, it is cheaper relatively. But the science of making silicon, pure silicon itself is a, since 3-4 years back it was in hands of only few people. Only 6-7 companies in the world was doing everything in silicon, no other, only 6-7 people. Now of course there are MEMC, Tokyama, REC, they are the new people, they are in more polycrystalline, but earlier people as I am talking about. This are the Mitsubishi, these are the main players earlier, but now there are many new people are coming, particularly in China. Okay, fine. So drift, you know a lot about it now, you are all expert of the drift mechanism of the charge motion, right? Now I will make an expert of the diffusion mechanism of charge transfer. But these are the two force which is always working in a semiconductor. So diffusion is, so the force behind the drift was electric field, okay. The force behind the diffusion is concentration gradient, okay. It is similar to like if I have only half of the people sitting here in this room, if the next person comes in, he is not going to sit there, he will sit here, right, where there is a space. So it is kind of diffusion happens, okay. Other very classical example of diffusion is the perfume. If I spray perfume here right now, everybody will know which perfume it is, right, because it diffuses. The concentration is more of the perfume particle here and it is less there. So the motion is always from the high concentration of particles towards the low concentration of particles. For example, you have one condition where all the particles are sitting at time t equal to 0, at x equal to 0, okay. So what does it mean? There is a lot of concentration here and there is no concentration here. So there naturally the diffusion will occur. And if you allow the diffusion to occur after some time t1, you will see the distribution is increased over the time distance, and some other time t2 which is greater than t1, it will further diffuse and diffuse. And if you wait for infinity time, what will happen? the concentration will become same everywhere. Concentration, so that is the job of the diffusion force, that is the job of the concentration gradient, that to make everything similar, uniform everywhere. Over a period of time, you have to wait for sufficient period of time. That the diffusion is the force behind the diffusion is the concentration gradient. Now, we have written expression for the current and current density as a for the drift. Can you write the expression for the diffusion current? Current is always going to be the same, right? You take drift or diffusion or anything, right? It's always charge per unit time. Can you write the expression for the diffusion current? Or what we need to know? If you want to write expression for the diffusion current, what do you need to know? Concentration gradient, okay. So let us say the concentration gradient is dN over dx, okay. That is our concentration gradient. Now what else you need? You need area, let us say area is A. And n is a number, right? So you need charge. So you can multiply with a q. What is the unit of this expression? Just find out. What is the unit of this expression? And we'll see what else needs to be multiplied. Do it quick. What is the unit of q a dn over dx? N is n. What is the unit of n per unit volume? Concentration per number per unit volume. So what is the unit? Coulomb. Centimeter square per unit volume n centimeter. Okay, so this will go, this will become 2 and this will go. So it's coulomb per centimeter square. I still need per unit time. So I need to multiply with something which has unit of centimeter square per unit time, isn't it? If I multiply with centimeter square per unit time, this will get cancelled, I will get coulomb per second, right? Got it? So basically, and that is true also, this is some coefficient which is called D, which is diffusion coefficient. Like mobility is related to the drift, there is another coefficient called D, which is called diffusion coefficient, which is related to the diffusion and having a unit of centimeter square per second. We can actually derive this also, and this is nothing but the expression for the current I for diffusion of electron. Q T Q, this is A dN over dx. Okay. Two important things we are going to do here now. So let me write fresh again. So I diffusion for electron is dq a dN over dx. I can also write similar for the following for the holes, right? Dq a. What should I write here? At the corner, my favorite students are actually corner students. If the corner students can understand, everybody else can understand. Corner, that's the idea. What should I write here? P, right? I'm writing a diffusion current for the hole, so I should write hole concentration gradient, right? Similar, that mobility was different for the holes in electron, diffusion coefficient is also different for the holes in electron. So I should write dN and dP, right? Now we have done one more important thing in the last time while writing the drift equation for the current. We have seen what is the force, electric field, and then we have seen what is the direction of the current, and we found out that the direction of current and electric field for both electron and hole is same. We should do the similar exercise here and find out what is the force, that is the concentration gradient, and for that concentration gradient, what is the direction of current. It is important to find out that, right? Got it the problem, everybody? I need to know whether my current is in the same direction of the force or is opposite direction. If there is opposite direction, I should put the negative sign, right? Let us do it. So suppose I plot n over x, right? And this is my plot of the concentration gradient, n over x, right? If I do the dn over dx, I can find certain constant, right? Fine. So I cannot point a straight line, then there is no gradient, right? The fact that I have not plotted a straight line, which means that there is a gradient. Concentration is changing with respect to x. Fine. Now, because of the diffusion, my carriers are always going to move from low concentration to high concentration. Good. Because of my diffusion, carriers are always going to move from higher concentration to lower concentration, which is this direction. Which is this direction. My carriers will always move towards the positive x axis in this case. Okay. What is the direction? What is the dN over dx? Where it is positive? dN over dx is concentration gradient. Is it positive towards the plus x direction or minus x direction? The concentration gradient is positive in the minus x direction. So this is my dN over dx. Right? Now, where is the current flowing? What is the direction of current? Direction of, so this is the motion of electron and current is this direction. Okay, so this is my I for electron. So what you can see here, the current for electron is in the same direction of gradient for the electron. So I shouldn't put any sign. It's perfect because both are the force, the current is in the same direction as my force. So I should not put any sign there, it is perfect. So this equation here is correct. Got it? This equation is correct. Following me, everybody? Everybody? Now, let us do it for the holes. What is happening? Do we have to put negative sign or not? Just do it yourself. Plot the profile for the holes. Plot the direction of the gradient, plot the direction of the motion and see the direction of the motion is in the same as the direction of gradient or not. Plot the profile first, P versus X. Don't make it a straight line, either horizontal or vertical, just make a slope, a curve like we have done earlier. See where is the direction of the motion, where is the direction of the gradient. So if I plot P versus X similar, the gradient is positive in this direction dP over dx, right. Holes will go from high concentration to low concentration, which means this direction, moment is this direction. And therefore, because it is holes, so current is also in the same direction, right. So I diffusion for the holes in same direction. So you see the force and the current are in the opposite direction, right. The gradient is in the minus x direction, the diffusion current in the plus x direction, and therefore I should put a negative sign here. Got it? So very important to find out the right direction for the current motion. So now electron drift current, hole drift current, electron diffusion current, hole diffusion current. There are four ways current can flow in a semiconductor. There are four ways current can flow in the semiconductor. And if I tell you any xyz direction, you should be able to give the direction appropriate equation for the current with appropriate sign. Got it, everybody? Very clear? This is nothing but the expression how the diffusion will actually have the distribution over the period of time equal. So starting, suppose the particles are in the one compartment, there are four compartments at t equal to 0. Over the time, the particles will start redistributing themselves, and if you look at the very long time, the particles will be equally distributed in all. That is nothing but the diffusion mechanism. And this is how we can derive the expression for the diffusion, that suppose this is the profile of the concentration. You have N1 concentration in one compartment, N2 concentration in another compartment. Okay. At a given time, the N1 particle will actually move in the either side. There is a good probability that it can go to this side. So, there is a good probability that the electron which are in this compartment can go to this side or that side. And we can say equal probability either side. Okay. So, after some time t, half of the N1 particle will be here and half will be here. And it is happening everywhere. So, after some time t, half of the particle in N2 will be here, half will be here. It will keep on happening. So, what you will see here is the half of the particle over the time t goes to the other side. And this way you can actually write the expression for the flux, that is the number of particles crossing per unit area per unit time. So that is a flux of the electron due to the diffusion. You can write it in the form of the gradient. You can write in the form of the gradient nx and n x plus delta x. So this width of the compartment is a delta x. So you can write the same expression in this form, and you actually write the expression of the flux in the derivative form dn over dx. That is what we are writing, and this is the flux, right? This is the number per unit area per unit time. What we are looking for? Current. So we have to still multiply by the q to get the charge per unit area per unit time, and then we multiply with the area, so you get this. So this expression here is nothing but we'll have the unit of centimeter square per second, which is our diffusion coefficient. And this is the flux. So as I said, we have to multiply by the charge q to get the number charge per unit area per unit time, and you multiply by the area, so you get the charge per unit time, which is current density, or sorry, current for the. So this is being replaced by dn, diffusion coefficient, and this is the gradient of concentration, and this is what you get the flux, right? Flux of anything is in the number per unit area per unit time. Flux of anything, flux of charge, flux of particle. Multiply by the q, you get the charge, and multiply by the a, you get the current. Okay, so the diffusion current density, right? J is equation of density, it's per unit area, right? And if I multiply with the area, I get I, right? J is the expression for the current density, and I is the expression for the current. So this is J means area is not multiplied, is here. So expression for the electron diffusion current, no positive sign here, you see. Expression for the whole diffusion current, there is a negative sign. And now we know very well why there is a negative sign, right? Right? We know very well why there is a negative sign. So there are how many components of current now? 4 current, electron, drift and diffusion, hole, drift and diffusion. So the total current in a semiconductor at any given time should have all this expression. So J total is Jn plus Jp, Jn is drift current and diffusion current, Jp is drift current and diffusion current. So total expression for the current is sum of all this, right? Sum of all this. Electron drift, electron diffusion, hole drift, hole diffusion, that is the total current in semiconductor. And under different condition, various components of the current gets modified. Under various condition, various components of current gets modified. Now, few important point to note here. Looking at this expression, what this says is minority carrier current can be significant due to diffusion. Okay. Let me write one expression for you, which we have not covered because of the lack of time, but so in any semiconductor there will be electrons and there will be holes always, right? One is in majority, other is in minority, right? So in any semiconductor the electron concentration is given n 0, equilibrium electron concentration, hole equilibrium carrier concentration is given p 0. Okay. And when semiconductor is not doped, it is given with the intrinsic carrier concentration Ni, right? For silicon, Ni is fixed because it is an intrinsic case. Ni is about 10 power 10 number per centimeter cube. Okay, this is fixed for a material. Ni is fixed for material. So if I look at germanium, Ni, that is intrinsic carrier concentration is different. If I look gallium arsenide, intrinsic carrier concentration is different. If I look cadmium telluride, intrinsic carrier concentration is different. So it is fixed for the material at room temperature. What can be proven is that N0 P0 is always equal to Ni square. Always equal to Ni square. What does it, and if I am doing the doping, majority carrier concentration, if I am doing doping, as we have taken example of 10 to the power 16 boron atoms per centimeter cube, it gives rise to 10 to the power 16 electrons per centimeter cube, more or less same. Okay, which means my equilibrium electron concentration is 10 to the power 16, Okay, now if I put this number here, so if I put this number here, so my P0 is equal to Ni square by N0. Ni is how much? 10 to the power 10. So Ni square is 10 to the power 20 divided by N0, which is how much? 10 to the power 16. So my P0 is 10 to the power 4. Okay? Because electrons are in majority, you have very huge number of electrons, 10 to the power 16. What is the hole concentration? 10 to the power 4. So hole is in minority, right? Hole is in minority and the number difference is huge. So my my N0 is 10 to the power 16 and my P0 is only 10 to the power 4. Okay? This is what normally is the situation. When you start with the silicon for making solar cell, your doping is of the order of 10 to the power 16. So majority carrier concentration is of the order of 10 to the power 16, minority is of the order of 10 to the power 4. Now 10 to the power 16 may become 15, 17. Yeah, it is not boron, it is phosphorus concentration. We are talking about the N, phosphorus concentration. Okay, fine. So coming back to the slides, so what does it mean? The minority concentration is much, much smaller, right? Several order of magnitude. In this case, 12 orders of magnitude smaller, right? Keep that in mind. So coming back here, this is a very important point to note for the solar cell perspective that here N, if I am talking about electron current density, here it is N and here it is gradient of N. Okay? This number will be large, the drift current density will be large if N is large. The diffusion current density will be large if gradient is large. Okay? For gradient to be large, N need not to be large. Gradient can be large. So if my concentration varies from 10 to the power 10 to 10 to the power 4 in 1 nanometer, then my gradient is very large. Right? Even my N is not large. So therefore, for minority carrier concentration, the drift current is always going to be small, where this number is very small. But the because the gradient can be large, the diffusion current can be very, very large for the minority carriers. And minority carrier plays very, very significant role in the operation of solar cell. Okay? Take a note, minority carrier plays very, very significant role in the operation of a solar cell. And therefore, current due to magnetic carrier flows due to what? Drift or diffusion? Current due to the magnetic carrier is always because of the diffusion, because then diffusion can be large. Otherwise, the number of magnetic carrier is so small, the drift current component of the magnetic carrier is always going to be very, very small. So the diffusion plays an important role, and therefore, magnetic carrier plays an important role in the operation of solar cell. Point taken? So we are making some progress towards the solar cell now. So these are the forces and this is the direction of current. You know very well how it has come, right? Electric field in this direction, current is also in the same direction due to the hole, drift and due to the, again one of them has to be, no, it is okay. Hole, drift and diffusion, electron drift and diffusion. So this is the gradient, this is electric field. And you can write the direction of direction, you can actually put the direction of current, right? Let me take a quiz. So this is direction of my electric field and this is N versus X. Okay, what is the direction of electron drift current and electron diffusion current? How many agree with him? How many do not agree with him? You agree with him? Raise your hands. If you agree with him, drift current is the same direction as electric field. Okay, so this is JN drift. Fine. Any objections? Okay, what is the direction of diffusion current? So this is my plus X direction. So tell me with respect to this, is it plus X or minus X? Diffusion current for electron is plus X or minus X direction. Now I just want with respect to this, this is my plus X direction with same as JN. I do not understand. Tell me plus X direction or minus X direction. So you are saying plus X? Who is saying plus X? Plus X, okay. Do you agree with her, everybody? No, some people don't agree. You don't agree. Okay, so there is a confusion. Let us do it. This is very simple, right? This is the electron will go from high concentration to low concentration. So they will go in this direction, right? And the current due to electron is in this direction. And we are interested in direction only. So this is in plus x, simple, isn't it? The electron will always go from high concentration to low concentration, and because my direction of electron is this, my current has to be in the opposite direction, and that's what I was interested in, the direction of current. So therefore direction of current is in the plus x direction. So J n diffusion is in the plus x direction. If this is the case, now things can be reversed, right? It can be this, that, whatever happens. Good. It's very important to understand. If you understand this, you understand a lot. Yeah, but this is my positive x direction. I mean, it doesn't matter, right? I can say any direction, but more important thing is this is how happening. So with respect to this direction, my current is in this direction. That's it. You call it positive x, negative x, you call it y, z, alpha, beta, gamma, whatever you call it, doesn't matter. The main thing is the profile. J diff is the direction of electric field. This portion from here below is all belongs to the diffusion. Yeah. Portion from here to here is all belong to diffusion. Okay. Go ahead. Should I go ahead? Okay. So now if I come to the that P-N junction diagram and tell you about which particle will go where, you should be able to understand. Okay, various values for the coefficient, you know, both all of these are very important. Mobility and diffusion coefficient are very important. Are the material property, they are dependent on the material that you are using, they are dependent on the process that you are doing, they are dependent on the dispersion technique that you are using. There are so many various ways in which this particle can be dependent. One other important factor that is, we do not go in detail, but as I told you yesterday, that if whenever you draw the energy band diagram, if you are not drawing the horizontal lines, which means there is an electric field, okay. As long as there is horizontal lines, there is no electric field. Whenever there is no electric field, there is whenever the bends are not flat, it means that there is electric field, and we can prove that, right? We always know that expression for the electric field is gradient of the voltage, right? That is electric field in the negative direction, and if you put this expression here, you can find out that whenever there is a gradient, this also means gradient of voltage also means gradient in potential energy, E is energy here. So whenever there is a gradient in the potential energy means that there is electric field, and what is this axis, by the way, always energy, right? So the line is not flat means there is a gradient in energy. What energy? Potential energy, which is given by E, right? Because my y axis is energy, and because these lines are not flat, which actually indicates there is a gradient, and the gradient actually means electric field. That is the message I want to give, right? In any band diagram, whenever you see in your life from today onwards, and whenever lines are not flat, it indicates electric field. Okay. Now, if your drawing is very bad, you may have a lot of electric field in your drawings, but make sure that you draw horizontal lines because it makes a lot of difference. It makes, and it's very important point, and it can play a huge role in making your device work or not work, or you actually improve the performance. And lot of people actually play with this. So this is another skill one should have, to draw the appropriate energy band diagram. if you can draw it properly, you know exactly how your device is going to work. Draw the appropriate energy band diagram. Okay. So, key thing from here is whenever line is not flat, it means there is an electric field, that is it. Okay. And why it is not there? It is because of this, simple. Electric field is gradient in potential. This is my potential energy axis. Because there is a gradient, it actually indicates electric field. Okay, Einstein has found out that the two most important parameters that we have seen, one is corresponding to the drift, that is mobility, other is corresponding to the diffusion, that is D, diffusion coefficient, are related to each other. Yes, they are related to each other. Again, we will not go to in the details of the expression how you are derived, but what is more important is the D and mu are related with kT by k. The more important thing is this is only depends on the temperature. It does not depend on any material parameter. So, ratio of D or mu does not depend on any other third material parameter, it is only depend on temperature. So, D by mu is equal to kT by q is called Einstein relationship. K is Boltzmann constant, T is temperature, q is charge on the electron. If you put the values there for a room temperature, you will find this expression is equal to 25.9, close to 26 milli electron volt. Okay. You will find that value to be 25.9 milli electron. Little milli electron volt? No, it is millivolt. Millivolt. This is centimeters square per second. This is centimeter square per volt second. Everything you will get is a millivolt. Okay. And only kT is electron volt. If you only expression kT, then it is energy, unit of energy. kT by q is unit of volt. Only kT is unit of energy. So if you are looking only kT, then it is 25.9 milli electron volt. kT by q is 25.9. Millivolt. Okay, that is the value of that expression. So D and mu are related with that. So, I think it should be true from this expression also. If you divide mu kT by q, D by mu kT by q, you should find the similar relationship. Okay, D by mu, D n by mu n, kT by q, dP by mu p, kT by q, should be the same.